This video was made possible through the support of my patrons. It's hard to have a retrospective look back on the series' 1-2 parter, The Empty Child and The Doctor Dances, without keeping in mind that its writer, Stephen Moffat, would be the one to inherit the showrunner mantle from Russell T. Davis after his 5-year reign on the show. Stephen Moffat, a lifelong Doctor Who fan, had previously made his name as a sitcom writer, as well as penning the 1999 comic relief special, The Curse of Fatal Death, with his wife producing, and an all-star lineup of parody doctors. His love of the show is apparent from this biting but affectionate spoof, making him an ideal writer for the relaunch. But looking further ahead at his legacy, it's interesting to see all of the questions and fundamental character searching Stephen Moffat would do for the Doctor. What does Doctor Who mean? Why did he leave Gallifrey? Which Doctor broke the promise? Who are the closest ones to him? Who are his influences? All of these questions Moffat pondered during his time as showrunner. All starting here, with the ultimate question Moffat asked in The Empty Child and The Doctor Dances. Does the Doctor fuck? Okay, in all seriousness, Series 1's second half is continuing its trend of darker and more mature storytelling, which I affectionately refer to as the AD phase of Series 1, that's After Dalek for those not in the know, and now we have the story which has easily the biggest and most justified reputation for introducing a new generation of Doctor Who viewers to the cramped safety of the back of their sofas. But before we can break down the horrifying nature of the titular Empty Child and all it entails, let me back up. Our story opens with the Ninth Doctor and Rose following an unknown extraterrestrial object through the time vortex and tracking it to London, England, Earth. The Doctor attempts to ask the locals about the large, loud object that fell from the sky, only to realise it's a fool's errand as he and Rose have landed in 1941 at the height of the London Blitz, where German bombing raids are a frequent occurrence. He loses sight of Rose, who investigates a lone child in a gas mask calling out for its mummy, and she gets taken for a ride on a barrage balloon, only to be saved by con man Captain Jack Harkness, played by John Barrowman. As Jack tries to negotiate payment from Rose, the Doctor explores the streets of London, happening upon Nancy, played by Florence Hoth, who looks after abandoned children, but is continually looking over her shoulder for the gas mask-wearing child, and knows more than she lets on about it. With more and more people in London being converted into gas mask zombies, it's up to the Doctor, Rose, and even Jack to determine the cause of the unusual alien outbreak and help or even hinder the child's desperate search for its mummy. Now, I don't think it's a controversial statement to say that The Empty Child might actually have been the scariest episode of Doctor Who ever broadcast up to that point. Doctor Who has definitely been unsettling and has had freaky monsters and spooky elements, but this is outright haunting and gets under my skin. Firstly, due to the London Blitz and a lot of this two-parter taking place on a night of an air raid means that we have the quiet streets, abandoned buildings, and dark empty corridors. It's an incredibly isolating episode, despite it having, on paper at least, a pretty large cast of supporting characters. It has a large cast, but these people are lost and alone, whether it's Jack working solo, the Doctor and Rose getting separated, Nancy and her children gathering for a meal, but once the child interrupts, they scatter, the kids travel to the meal alone, stalked by the child, and while there's about 10 of them there, only about half of them reunite in the next episode. The kids don't have anyone else, and it seems most, if not all of them, returned to the city after being evacuated to the countryside because of an unspecified abuse.
I make it 1941, you lot shouldn't even be in London. Should have been evacuated to the country by now.
I was evacuated. Sent me to a farm.
So why'd you come back?
There was a man there.
Yeah, same with Ernie. 2 moments ago.
Shut up. It's better on the streets anyway.
And this idea of isolation is present from one of the first scenes, as the underground nightclub with slow music, drinks, and joy gets broken up by the air raid sirens, leaving the Doctor alone on the stage after he's been made a fool of asking if something had fallen from the sky during the Blitz. Incidentally though, I do love how the Ninth Doctor demonstrates himself as a bit more human than prior incarnations. I can imagine the Fourth or the Sixth Doctors just barging onto that stage to make their important announcement, but the Ninth just stands in the doorway and lets the singer finish their number, even applauding them and letting the mood in the room reset before he starts asking his questions. But this sense of loss and loneliness stops becoming the subtext and starts making its way into the actual text when we look at characters like Dr. Constantine, played brilliantly by Richard Wilson, who only a few years ago had a whole family, but now cares only for his patients.
Before this war began, I was a father and a grandfather. Now I'm neither, but I'm still a doctor.
Yeah. Know the feeling.
And then there's Nancy, later revealed to be a single mother who hid her identity and relation from her son, which might not have caused the events of this story to unfold, but that lack of forthcoming and withholding Jamie, the child, his true origin, winds up in him feeling lost and unable to find his real mum when he's given the powers of a god. Indeed, the child is empty in that his head is literally a hollow gas mask with no features or eyes on the inside. But he's empty because he's got no one. From his perspective, the kids run away from him. He stalks the streets looking for his mum, and even his sister hides in fear. He lacks family, identity, understanding of where he has come from. He doesn't even know the full extent of his powers and abilities at first. This is complemented by the inclusion of Jack Harkness, a character who obviously has way more to give in the series and the whole Doctor Who universe proper, but in this story, him having lost parts of his memory ties into how important knowing your own past can be. Jack obviously has more sense of self and identity than the empty child does, but just losing 2 years of his life experience eats away at him. I guess you could say that the empty child is the friends we made along the way. Okay, that's going a bit far now. But yeah, I think that when fans claim this to be one of Doctor Who's scariest stories, I think they're right, but it's not just because of the jumps, the fake-outs, and the stellar atmosphere, but how this war has taken so much from everyone, yet there still seems to be no end in sight, and these people have been left behind, whether by choice or by circumstance. They're there to pick up the pieces. And if there's anyone in the series who knows about rebuilding oneself after a terrible war, it's the Doctor.
Thanks, miss.
It's all right. Everybody stay where they are.
Good here, innit? Who's got the salt?
Back in your seats. He shouldn't be here either.
I love this whole sequence of the Doctor at the dinner table, where he's got such a great interplay with the kids and he doesn't talk down to them. In fact, he's like a big kid himself, taking two slices of meat and getting told off by Nancy. We'd see this work as a core tenet of the Stephen Moffat philosophy when writing for the Doctor when he became showrunner. His ability to connect and empathise with children, which gets tested when the kids flee as the empty child knocks on the door. Obviously, the Doctor does not have all the info and the context that Nancy and the homeless kids do, but as they run in the opposite direction, the Doctor comes to the door and asks the kid if he's okay.
Oh. Mommy? Mommy? Please let me in, Mommy. Please let me in, Mommy.
You all right?
Please let me in.
You mustn't let him touch you.
What happens if he touches me?
He'll make you like him.
And what's he like?
Gotta go.
Nancy, what's he like?
He's empty.
And he stays at the door to talk to the child and try to get some of his questions answered, relating to this lone kid left out in the cold who says he's scared of the bombs. The Doctor opens the door, and while the child disappears, the fact that he opened that door on principle alone is incredibly telling. This understanding of kids also factors into the cliffhanger solution. Of course he'd think of sending the child to its room. He knows how to speak to kids. And also cats.
One day. Just one day, maybe. I'm gonna meet somebody who gets the whole don't wander off thing. 900 years of phone box travel, it's the only thing left that surprised me.
But speaking of Moffat tendencies, you can see the germ of his trope of being the first writer to do something brand new with the programme and its established elements and point it out to the audience. Case in point, the ringing phone.
How can you be ringing? What's that about, ringing? What am I supposed to do with a ringing phone?
As well as changing the dynamic of the doctor-companion relationship and making them swap roles and challenge just who is the doctor and who is the companion at any given moment. It's comparatively subtle here, to the extent where I think I might just be overthinking it, but we do have Rose calling the doctor her companion when talking to Jack.
I have something for the Time Agency. Something they'd like to buy. Are you empowered to make payment?
Well, I should talk to mine. Companion.
A companion.
But that brings us very nicely onto Rose's subplot, where she goes to check on the empty child, much like the doctor throwing away personal safety when they hear a kid in distress. But this ends up with her clinging onto a rope hundreds of feet above London during an air raid, which is a pretty glorious set piece and does a good job at getting her some distance away from the doctor and able to meet Captain Jack, who saves her. And the contrast between the doctor and Jack is obvious to Rose. Jack is younger, with more swagger, he also has psychic paper and sonic devices, but he's also got a flashy spaceship, tethered up to Big Ben. Early on, Rose laments the Doctor for not giving her any Spock, only for her to land in the arms of someone who will.
Not very Spock, is it? Just asking.
Door, music, people. What do you think?
I think you should do a scan for alien tech. Give me some Spock. For once, would it kill you?
Or maybe we should go find him.
And how are you gonna do that?
Easy. I'll do a scan for alien tech.
Finally, a professional.
We established last time that the Doctor, feeling quite possessive over his new companion, was potentially very jealous about Rose having another prominent male figure in her life. In Father's Day, it became apparent through circumstance that the Doctor's competition wasn't going to come to fruition this way. But with the introduction of Captain Jack Harkness, it starts becoming less platonic. Because when characters talk about dancing, they're not talking about dancing. In the classic series, there was a very asexual vibe to the whole thing. The Doctor in the past likely couldn't even comprehend these types of feelings.
Well, you're a beautiful woman, probably.
But with the Eighth Doctor kissing his companion in the TV movie, the floodgates have opened, and, well...
Well, that is all about sex. All of it. It's about the Doctor and Jack competing over Rose.
But it's not entirely framed as something positive or as a joke. In fact, the way Jack manipulates Rose by wooing her and getting her drunk does come across as rather predatory. And before you claim I'm here to hashtag cancel Jack or whatever, his motivator is money. I doubt he has any sort of malicious intent here, at least in regards to Rose's boundaries. So I'm editing this as all of that stuff is coming out. Obviously, the timing is bad, but I want to stress that I'm talking about the character of Jack, not the unprofessional on-set behaviour of his actor, John Barrowman. Anyway. But he knows what he's doing. He's using his charm to seduce this 19-year-old. He's using his sexuality as a weapon. But on the opposite end, Rose feels confident enough in her own abilities to do this as well. In The Doctor Dances, she actively volunteers to distract the guard, and I can't imagine any prior companion being so open to that apart from Ace, which further hits home the idea that Ace in the classic series walked, so that Rose in the revived series could run.
I can distract the guard.
How?
Professor, I'm not a little girl.
Though, let's set aside that she is still dating Mickey and that she's kind of acting like a dick here, that makes her a bit unlikable in my eyes. However, the Doctor is way less forthcoming about his dancing abilities. Rose has to pressure him and push him into answering why he doesn't trust Jack, and she admits that she trusts him because he's like the Doctor. To an extent.
I trust him because he's like you. Except we're dating and dancing. What?
You just assume I'm...
What?
You just assume I don't dance.
What? You telling me you do dance?
900 years old, me. I've been around a bit. I think you can assume at some point I've danced.
You?
Problems?
Doesn't the universe implode or something if you dance?
Well, I've got the moves, but I wouldn't want to boast.
You got the moves? Show me your moves.
Rose, I'm trying to resonate concrete.
Jack will be back. He'll get us out. So come on. The world doesn't end because the Doctor dances.
So we get this scene where Rose, confident that Jack will get them out of this locked room, wants to dance with the Doctor, and while he does take her hands at first, he gets distracted by the lack of wounds on her after hanging from a barrage balloon. The guy just can't switch off and relax during a crisis.
I've travelled with a lot of people, but you're setting new records for Jeopardy friendly.
Is this you dancing? Because I've got notes.
He is so bad at picking up these type of signals that the Doctor does not put two and two together immediately when Nancy tells him that her brother died on the same night the warship fell. I get the sense that if the link between Nancy and Jamie wasn't paternal, the Doctor could have read between the lines way quicker. Speaking of reading between the lines...
Feeding frenzy for the homeless kids of London town. Puddings for all. As long as the bombs don't get you.
Something wrong with that?
Wrong with it? It's brilliant. I'm not sure if it's Marxism in action or a West End musical.
And it's not just our main trio who get involved in the dancing action, as even some of the minor characters get in on it.
Half this street thinks your missus must be messing about with Mr. Haverstock, the butcher. But she's not, is she? You are.
Basically, all of the consenting adults in this story are really horny. But yeah, while the interplay between the Doctor, Rose and Jack makes the Doctor Dances a pseudo-horror comedy, The Empty Child is definitely more in the horror territory, exemplified by the scene where the Doctor goes to visit Albion Hospital, which randomly returns from Aliens of London, and he meets Dr. Constantine, and while he only predominantly features in this single scene, he makes an incredible impression. He's one of my favourite supporting characters of this whole series. Before he's walked into that room to greet the Doctor, he knows that he's not got long left and will die soon, but he's deciding to be sardonic and fun and go out playfully.
What would you say was the cause of death?
The head trauma?
No.
Asphyxiation?
No.
The collapse of the chest cavity?
No.
All right. What was the cause of death?
There wasn't one. They're not dead.
It's all right. They're harmless.
He had no reason to do that. He just wanted to mess with this stranger. And then he tells the Doctor that Nancy knows more than she's letting on, and her brother was patient zero. And then...
Mum... me... you... my... mum... me...
And this is the most terrifying thing ever shown in Doctor Who up to that point. It's an incredible effect and concept, and just the gas mask zombies in general are such a brilliant idea, especially when it's revealed that it's the nanogenes using the template of an injured Jamie wearing a gas mask, which is why everyone shares the same injuries, the same personality, and the gas mask isn't just something being worn, but it is their face. As for the structure of this story, its standing as a two-parter is so well justified. The Empty Child is concerned with setting up the time period, getting to meet and learn about the supporting cast, as well as asking exactly the right sort of questions. By the end of the episode, we do to an extent get the what, as these victims are being turned into gas mask zombies, and it started with the child. And we also get to know the who, as the cliffhanger has Nancy reveal that the child is Jamie and she's his sister. Well, we know that's not the case properly later on, but it means the audience do leave with 1,000 questions, but they still do have some solutions and some answers so they can piece it together for next week, which pays off the characters and gives us the answers that we seek properly. And it's all leading towards a satisfying payoff, which, despite the solution feeling rushed with arbitrary high stakes because the infection has become airborne and we have the bomb that Jack knows is going to destroy the warship as a ticking clock, this is just hurrying to the finale. The Doctor realizes that Nancy is actually Jamie's mother, and she has to to be honest with him about it and promises to not abandon him ever again, which allows the nanogenes to realise their mistake and fix everything, with a glorious demonstration by the Doctor, who wields the nanogenes to turn the zombies back to normal.
You want moves, Rose? I'll give you moves. Everybody lives, Rose. Just this once! Everybody lives!
This ending is so perfect because it takes the Ninth Doctor, the sole survivor of a war that destroyed his own people, and now in World War II, he gets to save everyone on that night in 1941. Captain Jack may have a sonic blaster and a spaceship, but the Doctor, he doesn't work like that. Without a shot being fired, without a single casualty, the day is saved. It's a personal triumph for him, and even Captain Jack, nobly opting to sacrifice himself and even prepares a final drink, he gets saved as well. He doesn't need a gun or a bomb or a warship. The Doctor, in full-on Father Christmas mode and absolutely showing off to everyone involved, dances to his own tempo. Rose and Jack danced to Glenn Miller's Moonlight Serenade, something the Doctor struggled with, but Nine is an in-the-mood type of Glenn Miller fan, and is able to dance around his TARDIS, sweeping Rose off her feet, and Jack comes to the understanding that he is not going to be able to come in between these two. As much as he'd like to, but I don't want this video to get demonetized. But let's wrap up by talking about the production, because this is one of the best looking and sounding episodes of the series so far, if not the best. The story is so spectacularly well directed. Not only is the lighting incredible, with it being lit well enough for the clarity of the frame and composition to come forward, but still getting across the bleak and gloomy feel of wartime London. Director James Hawes also clearly likes moving the camera long distances, whether it's the crash zoom to towards the child receiving the Chula ambulance signal, or the polar opposite movement, the slow reverse out of Captain Jack's ship, revealing that the TARDIS has parked inside. I also love how he films the Doctor's extended monologue towards the end, where it really is just a long take of the Ninth Doctor tearing into Jack and not letting him escape from the harm that he's caused. We also have the brilliant production design of the nightclub, the Lloyd's House, though where did Nancy find a dozen chairs in a house belonging to a family of three? Albion Hospital, especially the child's room, and speaking of that room, can we acknowledge how the sound editing works in tandem with the script to an extent where they can literally do the exact same scare back to back, but have it still work both times?
I'm here. Can't you see me?
What's that noise?
End of the tape. It ran out about 30 seconds ago.
I'm here now. Can't you see me?
I sent it to its room. This is its room.
Are you my mummy?
Jim. Sitting there, right next to you. So who's typing?
But these two episodes don't just work because they're scary. They work because they're telling a wonderfully human story about abandonment, about identity, about love, about sex, and it still manages to work in a family-friendly format and is delivered to audiences through a World War II zombie apocalypse narrative. Wonderfully clever, witty, exceptionally well put together, great performances, a strong cast. Side note, Florence Hoth really is brilliant here as Nancy. I don't have too much to add there, but I didn't want to leave her out. And that ending is glorious. Uplifting. Next week we conclude the trip of a lifetime retrospective look at each of these stories, because I've already reviewed the finale for Dalek Semba, so we'll be taking a long hard look at Boomtown, because those issues that I've taken with Rose about her boyfriend Mickey, those issues are going to come home to roost. So join me next week as we make our final stop on the trip of a lifetime. I'll see you next time. Hey everyone, thank you so much for watching this video. I'm kind of running out of things to say for the ending of these videos, for these end credit bits, but the show goes on, we've still got some more Trip of a Lifetime to explore. And I would also like to once again take the opportunity to, of course, thank you for watching, but also to thank all of my patrons who helped keep the lights on here. If you can't become a patron, that's okay, you can still support my content in other ways, whether it is subscribing, hitting that like button, leaving any comment below to appease the almighty YouTube algorithm. And I'd also like to give a particular shout out to these patrons. Anne Neubauer, Matthew Perry, Dean Jones, Andrew Blewett, Callum Baird, Daniel Davis, Dylan Whitaker, Flabu, Joseph Adams, Katie Maxwell, Luna Day, Palex, Raven Woods, Rebecca Hill, Shazeb Mangi, The Brit Sniper, Zachary Taylor, aka Mario Fanboy 15, Dan Morrison, Darius, Nathaniel Holden, Samuel Brooks, Zarby 555, Jack D. Evans, and Luke Jenkins. Once again, massive thank you for watching this video, and I'll see you folks next time.